It's a great day to be at church, and I want you to know how excited we are that you're locked in to CoFtv. No matter how you're watching, no matter where you are, I want you to know God is gonna meet you, your faith is gonna be strengthened, and you're gonna be filled with hope. Before we get too deep into our broadcast, I want you to do two things for me. Number one, I'd love for you to just take this link and share it on social media, text it to a friend, just share this link so somebody else can be filled with what God is doing right here through this worship, through this word. It is going to bless somebody if you share it with them now. The other thing I need you to do is I need you to engage just as you would if you were in a physical service, if you were in a building with other believers. I want you to engage the same way you would. Sing along, lift your hands, comment in and type amen. Everything that blesses you, I want you to push back to God. Our goal is to strengthen your relationship even through trying times. We're strengthening your faith. We're bringing hope to our city. Now let's jump into the sanctuary for worship.
Good morning, City of Faith. Wherever you are this morning, I dare you to worship our Father for his greatness and his goodness. We're going to lift up his name because he's the name above all names.
Call your name.
Hey, say I'm free.
forever. That's why we give him all of our praise. Come on and clap your hands right there. No matter what the situation, we praise you because you reign on high. And we love you. And we just want to declare that this morning. Come on and sing with us. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Let's be a source of hope for our city. Join us live on Facebook on Tuesday at 7:30 p.m. It's a moment we gain hope through prayer and worship. Hope for the City, live on Facebook, Tuesday, 7:30 p.m. During this time, prayer is mandatory, so join with our church family through our prayer wall on our app. Add your request for prayer or commit to praying with others. Ladies, make sure you're in our City Women Facebook group. Search City Women on Facebook now. We're starting a 5-day devotional together as a church family. It's called Believing God is Good No Matter What. Open the Bible in your City of Faith app and search Believing God is Good. We're starting Monday, so make sure you're ready. Make sure you're staying connected to City of Faith. Follow us on social media, download our app, and visit our website.
How many of you know that our God, He made a way? We don't know how you did it, but we're so glad that you made a way.
Yes. Don't know how, but you did it. Standing here, looking back on where we've come from, because of you and nothing we've done, to deserve the love and mercy you've shown, but your grace was strong enough to pick us up. Watching out, and you made a way. When our backs were against the wall, and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you
Father God, we ask you now that you speak to the hearts, minds, and lives of your children. Take away every other distraction. Let every other thing fade away, that we would hear nothing but your word. Take this word, divide it up a million different ways, so every person who is hearing, every person who is watching, would hear you speak directly to them. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to continue in on this series we've been in church called Big. I still believe that God is going to do something big in you, in your life. And so I want to teach from a very familiar story this morning, but I want to teach it from maybe an unpopular angle. Matthew chapter 14 is where we are. For the sake of this clarity, I just want to read verse 28 right here. And it said, Peter said to him, Lord, if it is you, watch these words, command me to come to you on the water. During this season, family, our focus has to be to remain in our most productive and powerful and prayerful state that we can be. I believe that God's plan for your life includes prosperity. I believe it includes power. But the thing is, we only get that through prayer. What are you saying to me? Make it make sense for me, PC. You can't expect big stuff without being willing to take some big steps. Something significant happens in the text here in Matthew chapter 14 around verse 22. In the earlier verses, we understand that Jesus has done just something that was unheard of. Jesus has just done this miracle that would shape the course of salvation for eternity. He fed what we know as the 5,000. And as soon as he finished with that miracle, as soon as that meal was done, the text says he sent the crowd away, and then he sent the disciples away, and then he stops and stays alone and goes and finds his own place to be alone with God the Father. The first thing that I need us to understand is that sometimes it's required and necessary that we disconnect so that we can connect. Jesus recognizes here that he has a need for time alone with God. He needed to be renewed and strengthened. I offer to us that some of us didn't realize how exhausted and tired we had become from trying to balance life and kids and work and ministry until just a few days ago. I believe that somebody probably laid down and didn't realize how worn out you were until a few hours later when you got up. Some of us didn't realize how much we needed some time away until we were forced into it. But I need you to understand that in this moment where we're having to be disconnected from the world, I need us to be renewed and strengthened. Let this be a time where we can recover a clear purpose of the assignment God has for our lives. Jesus was mentally tired. Bible talks constantly about how power was going out of him in the Gospels, and we understand that it was possible that he was spiritually exhausted, but as great as Jesus was, he knew that he could only pour out so much until he ran out. It is this idea that we talk about constantly here in Church City of Faith that many of us just want to be filled so we can walk around full. And that is not God's plan for our lives. He does not want to fill us so we can be full. He wants to fill us so that we can pour out. But in order for you to be filled so you can pour out, you have to find a way to come back and be refilled. And so there was this thing that I need you to understand is sometimes we're in solitude and sometimes we're in isolation, but I need you to know that it's required that sometimes we got to get in solitude just so we can step back and say, okay, Lord, now I need you to fill me.
I filled myself with so much stuff. The world has filled me with so much stuff. The world has filled me with questions. The world has filled me with demands. The world has filled me with stuff I need to do and I have to do, or fear or frustration or whatever else. But now, God, I need you to fill me with you. Fill me with your power and your spirit. And so during this moment, I prophesy over your life that this is not just a time of solitude, but a moment of refueling and refilling and refreshing, that you don't just have to disconnect and pull away from your normal world, but you're going to be refilled and refreshed with all God has for you. I prophesy that God is realigning you with power for your purpose. I prophesy that you're going to come out of this with more than you went into it with. And so Jesus goes away so he can get filled. Here he is at one of the high points of his life and his ministry. 5,000 people have been fed, and we call it feeding the 5,000, but the text teaches us that that didn't include the women and children. So this could have easily been a moment to celebrate, but Jesus decides to break away for a while to pray. But here's what's significant that I want you to see. He handles the miracle, and then he goes away to pray. But right after the victory comes a storm. Here's something big for note takers. Write this note down. Display consistency despite the circumstances. I want to encourage you, family, that you have to show consistency even in challenging circumstances. Make prayer your primary reaction. Hear me. Jesus didn't cancel his prayer time because everything was going good. I really want to encourage you, family, during this moment, City of Faith, remain in prayer. Remain prayerful. Don't stop praying. Don't stop seeking after God. Don't stay away from your Bible for too long. Don't stay out of your prayer closet for too long. I need you to understand, Jesus said, I know God just used me. I know we just saw a miracle that was shape the rest of eternity, but after that he still went away and said, let me have time with my Father. Verse 24, Matthew 14, 24, Bible says, meanwhile, Jesus is praying, but meanwhile, the disciples are in trouble far away from land. A strong wind has risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. While Jesus is praying, the disciples are literally fighting for their lives in the middle of a terrible storm. He had just proved that he could provide, but now he's about to prove that he can protect. Verse 25, about 3 a.m, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. Here comes Jesus. Watch this. Catch this. Please catch this. Here comes Jesus walking on what's wearing them out. Hear me, family. Jesus is walking on what's wearing them out. And because he took the time to step back and get plugged in privately, now he has the ability to show power publicly. I just want to encourage you with this and introduce you to this thought, that if you would step back during this time of what the world calls isolation, we have to call a moment of saying, let me get plugged back in. Let me get plugged back in to the Father. I don't know if you have not been able to go to work, but so much of the world has closed down for a few moments. So much of the world has shut down temporarily. So much of what our normal life is, we're unable to get out and go into. But I need to encourage you that while you can't get out, I need you to get in to the presence. While you can't get out into the streets, I need you to get into the spirit. I need you to tap in and plug in privately, because there is a moment coming when the world is going to open back up. And when it does, I need you to walk back out of your house with more power. When it's time for you to walk back into your office, I need you to walk back in with more power than you left with. When you go from working from home to working back in in your cubicle, I need people to walk by you and say, ooh, something's different. There's a different level of power sitting here right now than it was the last time I saw you. And so when the disciples in 26 and 27 see Jesus walking on the water, the Bible says they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, it's a ghost. But Jesus spoke to them at once. Don't be afraid, he said. Take courage. I am here. And just to pause and encourage you, the words Jesus speaks to us right here apply to the storm the disciples were in. And it applies to the storm that you're in. That Jesus says to you, don't be afraid. Take courage. Why? Because I am here. We are not walking through this alone. We are not walking through this without a Savior. We are not walking without a God who is around us and surrounding us and within us. We have a Savior. But let me give you this thing, because something tricky happens here is that the text says that when the disciples saw Jesus walking on water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, it's a ghost. If I give you one thing that will carry you through this week, if I give you one thing that you can stand on through this week, it would be this thought. Don't let the voice of the group be the voice of your life. Hear me, family. Don't let City of Faith catch this in your faith. Don't let the voice of the group be the voice of your life. And so the group spoke and said, it must be a ghost. We're all afraid. But then Jesus spoke and said, take courage. Don't be afraid. I'm here. The text says that the disciples, plural, the group thought it was a ghost. They cried out in fear. But then something crazy happens that I love in verse 28. Peter says, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water. So they cried out in fear, and Peter spoke up for himself and said, if it is you, call me, hear me, call me to come to you. He didn't say call us to come to you. He said call me to come to you. Peter in 28 and 29, he says to Jesus in 28, if it's really you, tell me to come to you. In 29, Jesus says, yes, come. He says, come. He says, yes, come on. It's not the yes, come. Yes, it's me. And yes, come on. And so Peter said to the Lord, if it's you, command me. Peter has this word that we got to sit in for a little while, command. He does not. That's why I love the wording of this translation. He said, if it's you, in the NASB, he says, command me to come to you. And so we're all praying for direction in this season, y'all. We're all praying for a word. But we have to be ready to move in response to what God says to us. See, the problem is we can ask for God to speak all day, but if we don't like what he says and we don't move in it, then we've done ourselves no good favors. Peter says, call me to you. And Jesus says, yes, come. But we just saw in the text that the disciples were afraid. The text didn't say they were afraid except Peter. The text says they were afraid. But Peter says, anyway, call me to you. I offer this question to you. What do you do when your command fights against your doubts? What do you do when your command from God fights against the doubts in your mind? what I'm offering, what I'm suggesting, what I'm encouraging, what I'm pushing you into, family, is that it's time for us to demonstrate our faith. It's time for you to demonstrate your faith. It's a season where it's necessary to demonstrate that God is still in control, and that you still believe, and that you still stand on his word, on his power, and on his promises. The enemy wants us to live in fear as if we don't know who is in control. But I need to remind you and encourage you with this. If I don't give you hope with nothing else, let this idea, let this thought, let this declaration give you hope. God has brought us out time after time after time, and this time will not be any different. He didn't run out of power at the last miracle you needed, and he's not gonna run out of power now. He didn't run out the first time you called. He came the next time. He didn't run out the last time you called. He still got some gas left in the tank to show up and pour out power into your life and your situation. This text is proof that no matter what God did the last time, he's still available to do it this time. Why? Make that make sense for me, PC. Jesus feeds 5,000 and then follows it up with this. Why? Because he's a way maker. And that has always been true, and it always will be true. His children needed him, and he showed up and moved on their behalf. His people needed him. Jesus fed 5,000 plus because the people were hungry. He saw a need and he moved on it. He goes to pray. The disciples get in the storm that's tearing their boat apart. And then next thing you know, Jesus comes walking on water and Jesus handles them in the storm. I need you to know it's not because he felt like it. It's because his people needed it. Do not feel like we're sitting in the middle of a troubling time, an uncertain time, a questionable and challenging circumstances. Do not feel like we're sitting in the middle of this and God does not see us and God does not hear us calling and God is not going to move in our situation. I promise you that God is going to stand up for you. He's going to show up for you. He's going to move for you. And even if that requires moving heaven and earth, he will do it for his people. So, 29, Peter says, if it's you, call me, command me. Jesus says, yes, come. Peter, the text says, goes over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. Something significant about the text here, he didn't just ask to walk on water. He asked to walk to Jesus. What am I helping you to understand? Maybe some of the miracles in your life would happen. Maybe some of your prayer requests would be answered if your focus was not on doing great things, but on getting to him. Maybe things wouldn't be so tricky if you weren't just focused on getting things done, but getting to God, getting closer to Jesus. Peter didn't ask to walk on water. He asked to walk to Jesus. Water was just what was between Peter and Jesus. So, what I love the most about this text is that the Bible says Peter gets off the side of the boat and walked on water toward Jesus. He leaves the other disciples on the boat. The ship was being beaten by the storm, but it was still safer than walking on the water. The boat was popular. It's where all the group was. Everybody else was on the boat, but his purpose called him out of it. what you're willing to walk away from determines what you're going to be able to walk into. When you have faith, when you have faith, God might just call you into a room or group or a job or a neighborhood or a school full of scary people. Why? So they can see what faith looks like. Yes, people might talk about you. People might hate on you. People might hate you, all because you did what they never had the mind to do. But I got to remind you of this word, and I really needed to shake you up in your house or wherever you are watching on your cell phone, at work, in your car. I need you to be reminded of this, and I need you to just give God praise for it. No matter how mad people get at you, sometimes you got to do what God called you to do. And what they couldn't see was because it wasn't for them. And what didn't work for them was all for one reason, and it's these three very strong words: you ain't them. Excuse, I know that's bad English, I know it's bad grammar, but you ain't them. So what didn't work for them don't mean God won't still do it in you. You ain't them. What God called them into may not be what God called you out of. Why? Because you ain't. You don't have to understand why I do what God called me to do. You don't have to understand why I sacrifice the way I do. All you got to know is you ain't them. You weren't called to status quo. You weren't called to comfortable and mediocre and average and stagnant and regular. You were called to move mountains. So hear me, church family, believers, you're not in a storm right now. The whole world is in a storm right now. The whole world is going through a challenge right now. It's not you, it's everybody. And Peter wasn't in a storm. I know with the text we only like to focus on Peter, but Peter wasn't in a storm. Everybody was in a storm. The whole boat, all of the disciples, the whole council of the disciples was in a storm. Jesus was in the storm too, but I need you to understand, it's not just you, it's everybody. But catch this very, very clearly. It's not just me, but I have to respond. And that's all I want to pull out of this text and encourage you with, that you can carry through your week and carry through your days. Peter was in a storm, but so was Matthew, but so was Luke, but so was John, but so were the rest of them. But Peter made a choice to respond with his faith. I know that you want to see God do something big, but the only way we see God do something big is that we respond in our faith. Everybody was afraid, but Peter got out the boat. Don't just focus on what you're in. See that everybody else is in it, and see what God wants you to do in it. This question that I need to carry with you: what does God want from me while I'm in this? What does God want from me? What does God want you to do right now? Seek God for what he needs you to do in this moment. What does God want from me right now? Wherever you are, while every head is bowed, just stop and pause. Close your eyes for a moment. Let's pray together. Let me pray over you. And I want you to pray with me as I'm praying. Because more than anything, I want you to use this time that we discover and get realigned with what God wants from us next and in this season. What does God want from me while I'm in this? So I pray now, Father, for direction. I pray for wisdom. I pray for guidance for your children. For every person that will hear this word in my voice, I pray for direction, for wisdom, for guidance. I pray against fear now. We rebuke fear now. Your people, your children, your sons and daughters do not have to walk in fear. Why? We will have faith in you. It's not about what we see. It's about the God we belong to, the God that protects, the God that provides. And so, God, we stand on you. We stand on your word. We stand on your power. I pray now that you put us in alignment with you. You put us in alignment with the purpose that you have for our lives, the assignment you've set over us. I pray right now, God, in the name of Jesus, that you reveal to us again the direction you want us to move in. And Father, I pray for provision over every person, over every household now. You make ways where we haven't previously seen a way. God, you provide, you raise up help where we need it, you send answers where we have questions, and cover us in this moment. I pray for the finances of your children, that there would be no lack in this season. I pray a special covering, a special prayer of provision over people who are having challenges in their work life. Whatever challenges are raising up in our work situations, I pray, Father, that you will step down and be Jehovah Jireh, the God who sees and provides. I pray now, Master, that you will protect us through all of this. Encamp your angels around us. Place a hedge of protection over us in Jesus' name and send your power. We believe. We stand on you. We will not let anything change the testimony of our faith. And we declare in every season, in every situation, in every moment that you are good. Strengthen our faith and bring hope to our lives. Amen.
Listen, y'all, in this season, there's all kinds of uncertainty, right? We really don't know what's coming. But what we are certain of is that God is faithful to his children. Since he's faithful to us, we have got to remain faithful to him. And one of the chief ways that we can be faithful is in our giving. So guess what? It's time to give. There are ways to give are on the screen. You can give through the app, you can give through our website, or you can give via text message. However you want to give, we just ask that you give generously and in response to how faithful God has been to us. So in these uncertain times, we can really be tempted to try to hold on. The reality though is this is not our harvest, it's just a seed. We know it's not our harvest because our harvest is bigger than this. So in these times, be reminded that God is faithful even when we're faithless. He is faithful even in uncertain times. So what's next for City of Faith? First of all, don't forget to join us for our church-wide devotional, which starts tomorrow. The link is in the comments. Click to join. We'll see you online Monday through Friday as we go through this church-wide devotional together. Also, remember, we're shifting our midweek service from Wednesday to Tuesday, so we want you and all of your friends to join us for Hope for the City. We need hope now more than ever. Tuesday night at 7:30, join us for Hope for the City. I promise you don't want to miss it. All right, City Women, if you haven't already joined our Facebook group, you need to now. If you haven't already connected, please log into your Facebook. If you don't have Facebook, join Facebook now so that you can then join the Facebook group and connect with your sisters. We miss you and we can't wait to see you online. All right, City of Faith, how'd you enjoy church today? I thought it was pretty good, right? Please join us next Sunday, same time, same place, here at City of Faith TV, where we are strengthening faith and sharing hope. We hope you have a great week, and we can't wait to see you again next Sunday.
And I know that all things work together for my good. And I know that all things work together.